drug problem that we have in the United States with college students and with people who are not in college, and that's alcohol. It far outweighs the problems of which are important, of stimulants and pain medications and sedatives, but sometimes it doesn't receive the attention that it really deserves. By the way, for those of you who are interested in this problem, there are some very good books, Correa, College Student Alcohol Abuse, and Dowdell, College Drinking, that I highly recommend as a way to become fully acquainted with the research literature on this topic. Alcohol misuse by college students is really part of a much larger problem in our nation, and that's the problem of alcohol use among all ages in this country. Alcohol misuse is the third leading cause of death in the United States. It accounts for nearly 90,000 deaths every year. And if we look at those deaths, the majority of them are injury deaths. And because injury deaths tend to affect younger people, they actually account for twice the number of preventable years of life lost. As someone who works as a director of epidemiology and prevention research, this, I think, is a very important point to bear in mind. It's really young people that we need to be we need to focus on. This is a list of the major causes of injury death according to the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention. Motor vehicle deaths being the number one cause, but poisonings or overdoses are increasing rapidly and may unfortunately soon surpass the motor vehicle traffic alcohol-related deaths as a cause of death. CDC estimates that excessive alcohol use costs this country about $250 billion a year. That's the equivalent of about $800 per person per year. I don't know about you, but I could use $800. Wouldn't mind taking a trip to Europe or using it in some other way. Of note, over half of the costs are borne by people other than those who misuse the alcohol. 42% are paid by the excessive drinkers and their families, but an equal amount by federal, state, and local government, and then another 16% by others. Why is that important? And when I think about the major public health improvements of my lifetime, probably the reduction in smoking is the number one that comes to mind. And the tipping point there was when people realized that the smokers don't just harm themselves, they harm other people. Well, the same is true with alcohol. In fact, if anything, I would suggest that misuse of alcohol has more immediate and more dramatic and larger effects than the misuse of alcohol. And that's very important for you as you try to justify to your colleges, universities, and communities why this problem deserves attention. At NIAAA, we've done epidemiologic research that has established what we call low-risk drinking limits. We suggest that it's not advisable for men to drink any more than 4 drinks in a day or 14 drinks in a week, women no more than 3 drinks in a day or no more than 7 in a week. Once people get above that level, they really increase their risk of developing alcohol dependence and other related problems. Now, this is not to say that the low risk limits mean no risk. Clearly, there are risks that are associated with even lower levels of alcohol consumption. Within the last week, there was a study that was published in Addiction about alcohol use being related to 7 different types of cancer. The relation to breast cancer, for example, is at very, very low levels. And there are certain people who shouldn't be drinking at all. If you're under 21, if you're operating a motor vehicle, if you're taking medications that are contraindicated with alcohol, people who are pregnant, elderly, frail people, people operating machinery, all these groups of folks shouldn't be drinking at all, and there's clearly risk for them. If we look at people who are sort of college age, they're the ones that are most likely to exceed the low-risk limits. 9% of the population, 18 and above, exceeds both daily and weekly limits, but 25% of those who are 18 to 24 exceed those limits. Young people, 18 to 24, are the ones that are most likely to experience alcohol dependence. 4% of the population meet alcohol dependence criteria, about nearly 8 million people, but 12% of the 18 to 24-year-olds meet those criteria. People that age, 18 to 24, are 16% of the population 18 and older, but they account for 43% who meet alcohol dependence criteria. So we're talking about a problem of young people. I think that there's been a whole paradigm shift in people's thinking about alcohol misuse. They used to think of it as, you know, dependence as a problem of middle age. It's not a problem of middle age, it's a problem of young people. And that's really where we have to focus our attention. And that's why I'm glad that you're all here today to talk about this. My institute has been interested in this for a long, long time. Back in 1998, they convened a task force of 25 college presidents and 25 researchers to take a look at the magnitude of the problem and what we know through scientific research can be effective to reduce the problem. By 2002, they produced a report called A Call to Action, Changing the Culture of Drinking at U.S. Colleges. This was mailed to every college president in the United States. It was updated in 2008, again mailed to every college president in the United States. The 25 background papers and the report itself were posted on our website. I'm happy to report that that website has received over 200 million hits since it was established. So people are very, very concerned about the work that you folks are doing, and I think rightfully so. I wrote the background paper for that report on the magnitude of college drinking problems and dedicated the article or the chapter that I wrote to a young man named Jonathan Levy. Jonathan was a freshman at Radford College in Virginia, and on Halloween he and some of his buddies decided that they wanted to go party hopping. So they went to a party and were there for about 20 minutes and then said, okay, let's go on to the next. They got into the vehicle with another student from the same college. I don't know that they knew that he'd been drinking, but he had. And on the way to the next party, he lost control of the vehicle that he was driving, crossed the center line, and slammed head-on into a vehicle coming in the other direction. The driver, the young man who'd been drinking, was killed instantly. Jonathan was killed. There was another college student in the back seat of the car named Travis Stedman. He was in a coma for over a week. He lost his left eye in that crash. And ironically, they crashed into a woman named Dr. Margaret Moore, who was a professor at the same college, and she was killed. She left four children in her wake. And you know, I think that this really illustrates in a dramatic way that we think about drinking problems among college students, we focus on persuading each individual student not to drink so much, when really there's a whole environment that we need to address. And hopefully we'll be coming back to that theme as I go along in my talk. Shortly after that report was released, my institute issued a request for applications called a rapid response to college drinking problems, and there were we matched up after a national competition, five of the leading researchers in the country with 16 colleges and universities were willing to test out new and innovative approaches to address this issue. There's a special supplemental issue of the Journal of Studies on Alcohol and Drugs that came out in 2009 that summarizes a lot of the what we've learned. We're still very much interested in this topic. We place a high priority at my institute on reducing not just college drinking, but college age drinking and related problems. I would say about at least a third of the budget of my division goes to research to prevent college and underage drinking. So how are we doing? Well, since the report was written, the baseline that we used in that report was 1998. And remember, the report came out in 2002. Unfortunately, we were sort of on an ascending limb of college drinking problems at the time that the report came out. From 1998 to 2005, there was a 3% increase in alcohol-related unintentional injury deaths among college students, going from about 1,400 to over 1,800 in 2005. But the good news is that since then, things have started moving have started declining. It decreased to 1,779 in 2008, 1,768 in 2011, 1,623 deaths in 2014. Because the college student population has increased from nearly 8 million back in 1998 to 12 million now, that actually represents about a 30% decrease per 100,000 students in the United States. If we look at national survey data, the proportion of, and this is the National Household Survey of Drug Use and Health, the proportion of college students who reported binge drinking increased from 41.7% in 1999 to 44.7% in 2005, but since then has declined to 41, then 40, then 37% by 2014. People driving under the influence of alcohol increased from 26.5 to 28.7, but since then has decreased down to 16.6% in 2008. So I believe that we're starting to turn a corner. Now, that doesn't mean that we can be complacent about this, because every year there's the beginning of a whole new generation of folks who are entering the college age years. I should also point out, by the way, that the highest proportion of people who engage in these behaviors are not the ones who are below the legal drinking age, but they're the ones who are 21 to 24 who can legally drink. This slide looks at the data of comparing 21 to 24 year olds who are in college to those who are not in college. And something very interesting to point out is that for many, many years, the 21 to 24 year olds who are in college were more likely to engage in binge drinking and to drive under the influence of alcohol than those who are not in college. But actually, we're bringing the numbers who are in college down to about the level of the ones who are not in college. So we're making some improvement, but it clearly illustrates that we can't just focus on college students. We need to focus on those who are not in college, who account for probably nearly twice as many individuals, and hence many more episodes of binge drinking and driving under the influence of alcohol as those who are in college. This is looking at the people who drove under the influence of alcohol. We can see that was going up, but then has started to come down. I should point out that, by the way, I start here in 1999. In 2000, there were only 17 states in the United States that had a legal blood alcohol limit of 0.08. That year, Congress passed legislation that would withhold highway construction funds if states didn't lower their limit to 0.08. And by 2005, every state in the United States had done so. So that may help to explain why we're seeing these reductions in the proportions of young people who are driving under the influence of alcohol. This slide looks at monitoring the future data, and the two points here that I'd like to point out are in 1994, again, only around 20 states had raised the legal drinking age to 21. That year, Congress passed legislation that would hold highway construction funds if states didn't raise the drinking age to 21. It was signed, by the way, by President Ronald Reagan. Reagan was the ultimate states' rights president, but he said when he signed that bill, you know, sometimes human young lives are more important than states' rights. And by 1998, every state had adopted the law. It became 21 became the minimum legal drinking age throughout the country. We can see that binge drinking among high school seniors was essentially cut in half since that legislation was passed. Among people who are college age but not in college, also a decline in binge drinking, not as great as the high school seniors, but nonetheless a very important decline. And even among the hardest to reach group, the one that you folks are trying to address, the college students, there has been a significant decline in binge drinking. This looks at alcohol-related traffic fatalities among 18 to 24-year-olds in the United States, and we can see a much greater decline, a 71% decline in alcohol-related traffic deaths in the 18 to 24-year-old age group than in fatal crashes that don't involve alcohol, a 19% decline. This is really a remarkable reduction in deaths. You know, we've gone from nearly over 8,500 deaths a year at the beginning of this curve down to around 2,600. So that's, you think about that, that's about 6,000 fewer deaths every year. How many people are in the room, do you think? Maybe 150, 200 people here? Think about 8,000. Fewer people dying every year in the United States as a result of the reductions. In the United States, since the early 1980s, alcohol-related traffic deaths per population have been cut in half. Over 300,000 deaths have been prevented. So this is an area where we have made substantial progress, and the role that all of you have played in that, you should be very proud of what you've done. You really have been contributing to saving a lot of lives. But unfortunately, during the same time period, overdose deaths, drug deaths, have increased dramatically. And actually, in 2008, for the first time, drug deaths exceeded traffic deaths. And most of those deaths are overdoses. And what's happened is that there's been a shift from overdoses from illicit drugs in inner city areas to prescription drug misuse, as Dr. Jay mentioned at the outset this morning, in suburban and rural areas, primarily painkillers and sedatives. So those are the two forces that are driving this. If we look at CDC data, we can see that the traffic deaths have gone down from an annual average from 2001 to 5 have gone down to, compared to 2006 to 2010, down 24%, but the poisoning or overdose deaths have gone up 56%. If we look at who are the people who are using these drugs, well, unfortunately, they tend to be binge drinkers. The people who drink heavily are the ones that are most likely to use these drugs. And that's a problem, because if people have co-occurring alcohol and drug problems, their judgment is often impaired, and they're more likely to take higher or larger and potentially more lethal doses of both. We know that if they use these substances simultaneously, that alcohol pharmacologically potentiates the effects, particularly the sedatives and painkillers. And people can overdose with a lower blood alcohol level if they have other drugs on board. If we look at, we looked at Aaron White in my division, and I published a paper not so long ago that looked at what's called the National Inpatient Sample, which is a probability sample of community hospitals across the country. Based on the data from that sample, it's estimated that there are 1.5 million people who are hospitalized in the United States as a result of overdoses each year. And about half of those people had alcohol on board. And if we look at the college age group, those who were 18 to 24, we can see that those who overdosed on alcohol only over a 10-year period up to 2008, those overdose hospitalizations increased by 25%. Those who had consumed drugs only increased by 56%. But those who had combined alcohol and drug before overdosing, that increased by 76%. If people use alcohol and drugs together, it has an effect that's probably more than just additive in terms of increasing risk. We know certainly from the traffic safety literature, experimental studies and epidemiologic studies, that there is an increased motor vehicle crash risk if people drive after a variety of drugs, including marijuana and sedatives and so on. It's not as great as the increased risk if people drive at a 0.08 or higher, the legal limit in the United States, but the highest risk is when people drive after simultaneous use of alcohol and other drugs. And that's the issue that I think we need to really be focusing on, is trying to prevent the simultaneous use of these substances. I've been involved with the National Institute on Childhood and Human Development in analyzing a national survey, a longitudinal study that they have been conducting. They began looking at people when they were in 10th grade. The data I'm showing you here are when this cohort of young people, this national sample, was 1 year out of high school. So some of them had started college and some of them were not in college. And what we can see is that a higher percentage of those who are in college are more likely to experience a variety of problems related to alcohol use. Being drunk, driving after drinking, riding with drinking drivers, hangovers, missing school, getting behind in schoolwork, doing something that they later regretted. Higher percentage in college than not in college. And they're more likely to experience harms caused by other people's drinking. The sort of the secondhand effects, being insulted, humiliated, serious arguments, experience property damage, having to babysit other drinkers, interrupted sleep, and so on. So, again, the people who misuse alcohol who are in college and same age not in college are not only more likely to harm themselves, they're more likely to harm other people. We know that the younger college students were when they first started to drink, the more likely when they're in college that they'll experience a variety of problems. Alcohol dependence, driving after drinking, alcohol related injuries, risky sexual behavior, and so on. There are nearly, according to CDC, there are nearly a million high school students and nearly 2 million 12 to 20 year olds who engage in binge drinking at least 6 times a month. As a group, they're much more likely to engage in a whole host of behaviors that put their own health and other people's health at risk. And between a quarter and a third of them are more likely to drink and smoke marijuana at school. Well, if you think about it, it doesn't take magnetic resonance imaging studies to let you know that if people are drinking and smoking dope at school, that they're not going to perform as well academically. And in fact, they're over three times more likely to be getting mostly D's and F's on their report cards. This is a national tragedy. You know, these people are losing opportunity to finish high school, to get into college, to get in the college of their choice. All of the institutions that you work for are affected by this problem. Their applicant pool has been diminished. Many potentially talented young people are not even making it to your doors because of the problems that begin even before people are college age. We know from a variety of research studies that the human brain is still developing until people are in their mid-20s, and alcohol has a disproportionately deleterious effect on the developing brain. If we compare young people who are alcohol dependent to those who are not, the ones who are alcohol dependent are more likely to experience problems with memory, spatial relations, judgment, executive functioning. You know, the early studies were small and cross-sectional, and people weren't sure, well, did the cognitive deficits begin before the heavy drinking, or did the heavy drinking lead to the cognitive deficits? We've encouraged longitudinal research on this, and now it looks like it's a little bit of both. People with cognitive deficits are more likely to drink more heavily, but the heavy drinking also increases the cognitive deficits. A study published a couple years ago started looking at young people when they were in fifth grade, even before they had started to drink. In fifth grade, people who later went on to develop heavy drinking patterns and those who didn't performed equally well on tests of mathematics and language. But when those who developed into very heavy drinkers, they took that group and they got them into alcohol treatment. And even after a month of supervised abstinence, they still performed less well on a variety of cognitive functions, prospective memory, verbal memory, visuospatial abilities, language and achievement. So even if young people who drink heavily manage to stop and to stay, to maintain low levels of drinking or no drinking, there may be effects that endure. We know now they've been followed for a month, it may be even longer than that. And again, the tragedy that produces is unmistakable. There are numerous studies that have shown that people who are heavy drinkers in college are less likely to perform well academically. And these are just a few of the literature reviews that have been done. So all of this underscores that there's an urgent need for us to expand and improve our prevention, screening, and treatment programs and policies to reduce alcohol-related harm, not only among college students, but among people who are under the age of 21, or people who are still in high school, aren't even of college age yet, among college students, of course, and among people who are college age, but not in college. We need to improve our surveillance of alcohol-attributable mortality. You know, none of our national data sets that look at alcohol-related deaths include college identifiers. So we have to, when we make estimates of how many college students die from alcohol-related unintentional or intentional injury deaths, they're estimates. We don't really know exactly. And I think we need to have college identifiers. And I think that all injury and poisoning deaths in the United States should be tested for alcohol so that we have a strong yardstick by which to measure whether or not we're making any progress. And again, colleges alone can't address this issue. Dr. Jay talked about the important role that colleges have. They certainly do, but you guys can't do it alone. You've got to work with the communities where your colleges and universities are located. Because for every college student, there are nearly twice as many people the same age who are not in college. And so they account for many more incidents of binge drinking and many more incidents of driving under the influence of alcohol and the other myriad of problems that I've been discussing with you. There's a whole culture that we need to change in this age group. The good news is that we have now learned that there are interventions that target many different levels of society that are effective in reducing alcohol misuse and related problems. Individually oriented interventions such as screening and brief intervention, social norms interventions, web-based interventions, mandated web-based interventions such as alcohol EDU, family, environmental policy interventions, and multi-component community interventions. We can intervene with all of these types of, at all of these levels and be effective. And I think where you folks fit in is that you're the ones who can tie all of this together, who can make sure that we don't try, there's no silver bullet. The more of these types of interventions, the more levels at which we try to intervene, the greater the likelihood that we're going to reduce the problems. And you're the ones who can coordinate those multiple levels of activity. National Institute on Alcohol Abuse and Alcoholism last year released what we call College AIM. We had some of our best researchers review the literature on individually oriented interventions and environmental policy interventions targeting college students. At the individual level, highly effective interventions that are low cost are listed up here. Medium cost and high cost, all of these were deemed to be highly effective. This is after they reviewed over 60 different interventions, and at the individual level, over 200 research articles were reviewed in preparation of this. They looked not only at how many studies had been done, what the quality of the studies were, the strength of the findings, the costs of intervening at these levels, the barriers, and ways that people can overcome those barriers. In terms of environmental interventions, the low-cost ones are but highly effective are seen here, retaining the legal drinking age of 21, retaining bans on reducing happy hours and bans on Sunday sales and so on. Have any of you seen this document? How many? Raise your hand if you've seen it. Well, oh, I hope you find it helpful. What we tried to do was create a menu, because obviously not all colleges and universities are the same. Their students and their environments vary. But the idea here was to give you folks the best set of available options to from which to pick to reduce problems on your campus. Okay, let's look at individually oriented interventions. I heard this morning about the screen U that has been developed here. Screening and brief intervention, there is a tremendous literature that shows that screening and brief intervention, brief alcohol counseling interventions are highly effective. I list here not individual studies, but literature reviews that have all reached the same conclusion. Here's additional ones looking at college students. In fact, the most recent one, Scott Sheldon, the most recent literature review, general literature review, well, two of them. One, Tanner Smith, looked at 185 different studies of screening and brief intervention for adolescents and adults. The U.S. Preventive Services Task Force says that there's strong evidence that screening and brief intervention is effective for adults in primary care, but said insufficient evidence for adolescents. Well, Tanner Smith, in this review, actually found stronger and more enduring effects when screening and brief intervention is done with adolescents for adults than for adults. Why is that important? The U.S. Preventive Services Task Force, if they say something's effective, then it can be reimbursed under the Affordable Care Act. I hope that they'll reconsider. They said there was insufficient evidence for adolescents. I hope that they will reconsider the adolescent literature so that these folks too can be, providers can be reimbursed for providing screening and brief intervention with adolescents. In addition to the Tanner Smith review, Scott Sheldon at Brown University reviewed 41 studies of college students with 62 individual or group interventions and concluded that screening and brief intervention is so effective with college students. If you look at the bottom line here, they recommend routine screening of all incoming college students in the United States. That makes sense. The average college student has at least one university health service visit a year. So if every time a college student had a university health service visit, they were asked and counseled about their alcohol consumption, there's a potential for population level effects and reductions because we know that screening and brief intervention is effective. Samson, last year, looked at screening and brief intervention for heavy drinking college students, those many of whom were required to have screening and brief intervention because of disciplinary actions. So these are not people who sort of go there voluntarily, but these are ones that have the worst problems, and even with this group, it's been found to be effective. It's also been found to be effective not only in reducing heavy drinking, but related problems such as driving under the influence of alcohol. This is a study by Steinke Fry that was published just last year showing that effect. Unfortunately, however, we have an implementation gap. We did a national survey a few years ago of people who are 18 to 39, and we asked them, had they seen a physician in the past year? Two-thirds had, but only 14% were both asked about their drinking and given any kind of advice about what levels of drinking pose harm. Only 14%. And what group was the least likely to be asked about their drinking? 18 to 24-year-olds. Precisely the group that's most likely to exceed low-risk drinking limits and to meet alcohol dependence criteria. So precisely the people who should be on the radar screen are not. I spoke at the 30th anniversary of Mothers Against Drunk Driving, and a woman came up to thank me for what I do. And as she approached the stage, she suddenly burst into tears. And I mean, literally bent over and couldn't talk to me. She had lost her daughter, Helen Marie Witte, 10 years earlier. Helen Marie was rollerblading in a park when a group of intoxicated teenagers in an automobile skipped over the curb and crashed into their daughter and killed her. We did a national study, again, that I mentioned to you earlier with the National Institute of Childhood and Human Development. We published an article last year in JAMA Pediatrics. We found that this is when they were 1 year out of high school, that three-quarters who were in college and three-quarters who were not in college saw a physician in the past year. A little under half were advised about the risks that were associated with alcohol use, smoking, and drug use. But oddly enough, the college students were the least likely to be advised to reduce or stop drinking, less so than the proportions that were advised to reduce smoking and drug use. Even among those who reported that they'd been drunk six or more times in the previous month, only about a third of college students were asked by their providers to reduce or stop their drinking, compared to 43% who are not in college. Why on earth providers are less likely to advise college students, you know, to give them advice to reduce their drinking if they're consuming that much alcohol compared to non-college, same age people. I don't know, but it really is something that is very perplexing to me. What are some of the barriers to providers asking these questions? Well, it takes time to ask the questions. It takes time to respond. There's a lack of training. That's why my institute has prepared manuals for physicians about how they can screen and do brief counseling interventions. There's lack of treatment centers for referral, and there are reimbursement issues. Let me ask you, how many of you live in states in blue? Raise your hand. Do you know that in your states there are laws on the books that allow insurance companies to withhold reimbursement for medical treatment of people who've been injured under the influence of alcohol or drugs? Think about that for a minute. That's a terrible disincentive for providers to find out, why are these people coming to our offices to begin with? How many of you live in states in pink? Good news is your states have repealed those laws recently. So an important research question, it seems to me, is whether or not in your states there's a greater proportion of young people who are being screened and counseled about their alcohol and drug use relative to the states in blue. Wilson Compton, who's the deputy director of NIDA, and two of our researchers at NIAAA, did a very interesting study where they found that the single screening question, how often do you have four more drinks if you're a woman, how often do you have five or more drinks if you're a man, that we use to identify people who are engaging in risky alcohol use, that single question actually is a very good predictor of whether or not they also have drug-related problems. There have been a number of studies of screening and brief intervention for drugs. In 2014, there were three very high-profile studies that were published in JAMA that found that screening and brief intervention for drugs in adult primary care was not effective. Now, all three of those studies, these are rigorous studies, are well done, but they focused on inner-city, low-income, unemployed, single populations with mental health comorbidities. There may be issues, it seems to me, of generalizability from those three studies. There have been some other studies that show that screening and brief intervention for drugs is effective. And while not as many as in screening and brief intervention for alcohol, the literature is starting to emerge. And here's some additional ones that show that it has some benefit if you do screening and brief intervention for drugs. Tanner Smith last year published a meta-analysis where she looked at studies of screening and brief intervention for alcohol, found that yes, if you do screening and brief intervention for alcohol, it reduces alcohol misuse and related problems, but there was no carryover benefit to drugs. However, if providers do screening and brief intervention for both alcohol and drugs, it looks like there are reductions in both alcohol misuse and drug misuse and related problems. So the literature is starting to emerge that would suggest that we shouldn't just screen for alcohol. Certainly that's where we should start, but we should also screen for drugs. I think the evidence that we've heard so far this morning would all indicate that if these things are used simultaneously, that's where the highest risk of problems is, and that's where we ought to be focusing our attention. Social norms and interventions. Many college students and young people feel that their peers are drinking more than they really are. And that leads to peer pressure for them to drink more. So people have tried what we call social norms interventions to correct those misperceptions. What does the evidence tell us about the effectiveness of these studies? This is a Cochrane review of 66 experimental studies of this, most having been done in the United States. At four more months follow-up, they saw small reductions for web and face-to-face feedback, alcohol-related problems, binge drinking, frequency of consumption, and peak BAC levels. They didn't see reductions if the studies, if the venue was mailed feedback or group face-to-face, or the social norms marketing programs, which are very common on college campuses. You know, the newspaper articles or the billboards that say that only some small percentage of people engage in binge drinking. They felt that the effects they were significant, but by themselves were unlikely to provide any advantage in practice. How many of you are at campuses where alcohol EDU is used? Probably the most widely used intervention for college students in the United States. How many of your campuses is that the primary intervention? Well, I'm delighted to see no hands going up for that, because we funded a study that was done by the Prevention Research Group out in California. They randomized 32 colleges that had never before used any kind of web-based intervention. Half of them were randomized to receive alcohol EDU. Those are the bullets here indicate the intervention, the components of the interventions. They surveyed these folks during the summer before they began college, during the fall, and then again during the spring. And what they found was that there were significant reductions in drinking and related problems during the fall, during their first semester of school, if they received the alcohol EDU. But unfortunately, by the spring, the benefits had dissipated. So they said, you know, what we need to do in the future is do research on boosters and how can we achieve longer term effects. To me, it kind of reminds me of, I was in Heathrow Airport about a year ago in London, and I was reading the book about the Wright brothers, David McCullough's book, and any of you had a chance to read that, it's a great book. And I was looking at all these big jumbo jets coming in and out of Heathrow, and I thought to myself, you know, when the Wright brothers first, who, from Ohio, by the way, Ohio gave flight and light to the world. For all of those who went to high school, you probably learned that slogan here. When they first flew, they didn't fly very high, and they didn't fly very far, but they flew. And I think that's what we need to do with some of these interventions, like the social norms interventions or like the alcohol EDU, is we need to improve them. If we can make the improvements that the aviation industry has made, then maybe we'll be able to fly high and fly far and really reduce a lot of these problems. By far, the most important influence on young people's drinking is family. Children of parents who binge drink compared to those who are abstainers are twice as likely to engage in binge drinking and to meet alcohol dependence criteria. A lot of parents think it's a good idea to provide alcohol to their kids at home. If they do, they think they'll learn to drink under supervision, they won't drink as much, there won't be this forbidden fruit. Have any of you heard this argument from people? Actually, it's been pretty well studied, and sorry, that's not the case. If parents provide alcohol, it was generally in these studies associated with increased adolescent alcohol use, increased heavy episodic or binge drinking, and higher rates of alcohol problems. And the evidence were equivocal as to whether or not there was any protective effect. We know family interventions, such as those done by Dick Spoth, the Iowa Strengthening Families Program, which tries to improve parent-child relations, strengthen family communication skills, and child coping skills, that those interventions done in middle school, by the time people are high school seniors, they're one-third less likely to drink to intoxication compared to those not given the intervention, and the results persist until they're college age, until they're 21. So family interventions, which they're now testing out in numerous states across the country, have demonstrated effectiveness. Now, a lot of parents think that when their kids go away to college, that that's it, the gig is up, that they no longer have influence over their children's drinking. Well, there's been research that shows if you send parents booklets about how to communicate with their children when they're in college, an experiment was done out in California where they sent parents booklets about how to communicate with their children in college. And to make sure that they read them, they asked them to rate the booklets. So if you hadn't read it, how could you rate the booklet? Those who read the booklet and rated them, their children, if they hadn't started drinking prior to entering college, were less likely to start. And even if they had started drinking, they were less likely to have their drinking accelerate to dangerous levels. So parents can make a difference in discussing these issues with their children. Now, there are a whole host of environmental policy interventions that reduce drinking and driving and alcohol-related problems. Most of them have focused on drinking and driving, so a whole host of drinking and driving laws, raising the legal drinking age to 21, policies that reduce access to alcohol, reducing alcohol outlet density, and increasing the price of alcohol. Young people have less discretionary income, so if you increase the price of alcohol, they're less likely to drink and experience related problems. I'll talk a little bit about the age 21 law. Because I don't know if any of you remember this, but a few years ago there was a thing called the Amethyst Initiative. Any of you heard of the Amethyst Initiative? The idea, there were 130 some college presidents who said we ought to consider lowering the drinking age to 18, teach people how to drink safely, and if they don't drink safely, give them drinking licenses, but take away those licenses if they don't drink safely. Well, no evidence that that kind of approach would work. By the way, the 130 college presidents signed this thing, so it got on the radar screen. How many college presidents are there out there? Anybody know? Anyone have any idea? There are over 3,000. So 134 is not a big group of college presidents, really. One of their arguments was that the minimum drinking age of 21 drives drinking underground into unsupervised circumstances. Which leads to explosive drinking. Any of you heard that argument? Well, actually, when we look at our national surveys, the people who are 21 to 24 who can drink legally are much more likely to drink 10 or more drinks on an occasion or to have as many as 21 drinks. That's a fifth of hard liquor on an occasion, exceedingly dangerous. So in college, it's particularly the ones who are 21 to 24 that are engaging in these behaviors, much more likely than those who are under the legal drinking age to do that. Another argument they often cite is, oh, if only we could teach our kids to drink like they do in Europe. They don't have problems over there. They've got lower legal drinking ages than we do. Well, there have been two multinational studies, one done by a group in Sweden called the ESPAD study, another done by the World Health Organization, that both show the same thing. They looked at 15 to 16 year olds, asked them, have you been drunk in the past year? This is the proportion of 15 to 16 year olds in the United States. But look at this, unless I'm misreading this chart, in almost all these European countries, there's a greater proportion of 15 to 16 year olds who are drinking to intoxication than here in the United States. Now, Europe has a higher age of driving licensure than we do in the United States, and they have lower legal blood alcohol limits, so we might want to think about what are the benefits of those things. But I think in terms of legal drinking age, maybe the Europeans ought to be looking at us. In fact, a year ago, I was asked to speak to the World Health Organization, 134 countries, and to talk about the legal drinking age of 21 as an example of a case study of a successful alcohol policy that should be adopted around the world. The idea that Europeans have figured this out is a myth. Europe has the highest per capita alcohol consumption of any region in the world, the highest percent of deaths that are alcohol related, the highest alcohol attributable burden of disease, both death and disability, and the highest prevalence of people with alcohol use disorders. So should we be looking to Europe about the drinking age? I don't think so. These are data that I showed you earlier showing that the binge drinking among high school seniors was cut in half after our drinking age was raised to 21. This is alcohol-related traffic deaths among those who are under 21. No age group has had the decline in alcohol-related traffic deaths than those who are 16 to 20 in the United States. CDC reviewed nearly 50 studies, found that when the drinking ages were being lowered back in the 70s and early 80s, that there was an increase in alcohol-related traffic deaths. When the drinking age was raised, there was a 16% decline in alcohol-related traffic deaths in the targeted age groups. Jim Fell, one of our researchers, did a study where he controlled for a whole host of potential confounding factors, looked at the ratio of drinking to non-drinking drivers in fatal crashes, and found, just as the earlier study did, that there was a 16% reduction in states that raised the drinking age to 21. Also found something interesting, that was that a number of laws aimed at adults also further independently reduced alcohol-related traffic deaths among young people. I think if we say to young people, you're the problem, and don't recognize that all of us could be part of the problem, that they'll regard it as hypocrisy. We're most effective if we try to address this among all ages in the population. Bill DeYoung, who I worked with at Boston University, actually I hired him away from Harvard, wrote an article in Journal of Studies on Alcohol and Drugs a year or so ago, and the title says it all, Case Closed, Research on the Positive Public Health Impact of the Age 21 Minimum Legal Drinking Age. According to the National Highway Traffic Safety Administration, over 30,000 lives have been saved as a result of raising the drinking age to 21. I think it's an underestimate for a couple reasons. One, they focused only on traffic deaths. They didn't look at the myriad of other problems that are associated with alcohol misuse among people under 21. And they didn't look at the long-term benefits. We have a researcher, Norberg, that we funded, who looked at national surveys of adults and compared people who grew up in states where they could drink legally before 21 to those who couldn't drink legally before 21, and found that those who grew up in states where they could drink legally before 21 as adults were more likely to experience alcohol abuse, alcohol dependence, drug abuse, and drug dependence. So there's carryover benefit of having a legal drinking age of 21. Just a week or two ago, an article was published by Plunk looking at chronic disease deaths, comparing people who grew up in states where they could drink legally before 21 to those who grew up in states where the drinking age was 21. And they found that compared to those who lived in those, who grew up in the states where they could drink legally before 21, those who grew up in those states as adults were more likely to die from alcohol liver disease, other liver disease, and lip and oral cancer. About a 5% lower levels if people grew up in states where they could only start to drink legally at 21. And that accounts for about 1,800 deaths a year, just in those chronic disease deaths. So there's clear evidence that having a drinking age of 21, it's quite consistent with the national survey data that show the earlier people start to drink, the more likely they are to develop dependence. People start to drink at 14, over 40% at some point develop alcohol dependence compared to only 10% who wait until they're 21 or older to start to drink. And this has been found even in studies of identical twins, where they look at one twin starts to drink earlier than the others. The ones who start to drink earlier are more likely to develop alcohol dependence. So even after controlling for genetics, this relationship persists. We found, by the way, that it not only is it related to starting to develop dependence, but it starting to drink at an earlier age is related to developing dependence at an earlier age, to developing chronic relapsing dependence, characterized by more episodes, longer episodes, meeting more of the diagnostic criteria. We dedicated that article to a young man named Brian Paul McKelvey. Brian, at age 16, had developed a serious alcohol problem. His family and friends persuaded him to get treatment. He was doing well. He was in recovery. But at age 19, he was struck and killed by a repeat offender drinking driver. So while treatment's important, we can't just treat our way out of this problem. Earlier drinking onset has also been found to be related to motor vehicle crashes, unintentional injuries, physical fights after drinking, injuring oneself or other people after drinking, motor vehicle crashes because of alcohol and drug use. And I like to dedicate my articles to people. I told this to a woman who was helping me organize a conference about youth and alcohol, and all of a sudden tears welled up in her eyes. She had lost her son, Michael Timothy Wilder, 18 years earlier. I thought I was being sensitive, but I don't think I really understood the enduring pain that some people, families, experience as a result of alcohol misuse by young people. It hit me between the eyes like a 2x4. Its early age of drinking onset has also been associated with suicide, violent behavior, dating violence, criminal behavior, prescription drug misuse, and unplanned, unprotected sex after drinking. Why is all this important? It's important because injuries are the leading cause of death in the United States among young people ages 1 to 44, and alcohol misuse is the leading contributor. So what are we talking about? What are you addressing? The leading contributor to the leading cause of death among young people in the United States. We still have some questions about the legal drinking age. In about half the states, parents can provide alcohol to their kids. What would happen if we close those loopholes? In 47 states, people under 21 can serve alcohol at bars or restaurants. I think a particular temptation if their teenage friends try to purchase alcohol. So we need to find out what would be the impact of removing these loopholes. Another issue that's recently become important to look at is how can we reduce extreme binge drinking. Megan Patrick did a study of monitoring the future data and found that about 5% of people, high school seniors nationwide, consumed 15 or more drinks on an occasion in the last 2 weeks. 15 or more drinks, the average man would reach a blood alcohol level of 0.3, a woman of 0.4. On an empty stomach, even on a full stomach, 0.2, 0.3, half the people experience blackouts at 0.2. So this is a very dangerous level of drinking. And unfortunately, over a five-year period, binge drinking at lower levels was declining, but not binge drinking at this very high level. We need to find out what's the effect of things like social host liability. It does appear that those laws reduce drinking and driving fatalities. Jim Fell, again, published a study of 20 different underage drinking laws and found that 9 of them produced significant alcohol-related reductions in alcohol-related traffic deaths involving drivers under 21. This is the list of laws. He said, collectively, the 9 laws prevent over 1,000 deaths each year, but 210 more lives each year, about the number of people in this room, could be saved if every state adopted all of those laws. Is it enough to pass laws? No, it's not enough to pass laws. This was a study done in Washington, D.C., the nation's capital. Young people were given money to purchase alcohol. 98 times out of 100, people under 21 were able to buy alcohol. So it's not enough to pass these laws. There's a whole process of police and court enforcement that needs to take place if we're going to change attitudes, deter people from driving after drinking, and reduce alcohol-related traffic fatalities. And that's best done at the community level. This is a list of multi-component community interventions that had been done that show effective reductions in alcohol misuse and related problems. And the good news is that we're actually seeing these kinds of studies being done with colleges and the communities in which they reside that show reductions. The programs coordinate multiple city departments. They have clear, measurable goals and strategic plans, combine law enforcement and education, include screening and early interventions, use data to plan and evaluate, and involve private citizens and organizations that involve young people. Ann McCart, Insurance Institute for Highway Safety, looked at this type of program in at Marshall University and in Huntington, West Virginia. They did sobriety checkpoints, saturation patrols, compliance checks, roadside surveys where they tested for alcohol, and found that when the colleges and the communities that they were in were working together on this, that they reduced the proportion of drivers who were driving with elevated blood alcohol limits, those who are under 21, those who are college age, and those who were adults. Bob Salt, Safer California University, didn't focus on reducing individual, focus on persuading individuals to drink less, but focused on where were the problems taking place. They were taking place off-campus parties, and so they set up a variety of interventions to reduce heavy drinking at off-campus parties, including social host campaigns, social host ordinances, party patrols and so on, and they found in the universities that received this intervention roughly 1,000 fewer incidents of intoxication each year at these off-campus parties and at bars, relative to 10,000 fewer relative to the comparison universities. Mark Wilson did a similar sort of intervention in multiple colleges and universities in North Carolina, and they found there that they not only reduced alcohol problems that heavy drinkers experience themselves, but they reduced harms to other people. So I think in conclusion, we've got evidence that we can reduce underage and college drinking by focusing on a variety of different levels, at the individual level, social norms, web-based, mandatory web-based interventions, policy interventions, and interventions that target multiple levels are much more effective than those. There's no silver bullet in all of this. We still have some unanswered questions. Will environmental interventions combined with screening and increased screening and brief intervention be more effective than either alone? Are those that target both underage and young adults more effective than those who target underage only? Are programs to reduce youth consumption, will there be carryover benefits to adults? Will they also reduce drug use? How can we sustain these things over time? And what types of interventions are most effective at the least cost? Let me conclude, though, by saying, you know, we are making a difference. We are bringing these alcohol-related traffic deaths and other problems down. We're making a difference. It's a shame, you know, that you guys don't each get dozens of thank you letters every year for the work that you do. You don't, when you're in the prevention business, you know, the people you help, they don't know who they are. But if you look at the data, they're there. You're helping them. And so my congratulations goes to every one of you in this room for what you do. And let me conclude by asking you, have any of you ever read this book, Polio, an American Story? Great book. It's about the competition between Sabin and Salk to develop the first polio vaccine. It reads like a novel. It got a Pulitzer Prize in history. And there are a lot of lessons to be learned from this. One is the power of grassroots activism. It wasn't the NIH that funded the original experiments to show that these vaccines were effective. It was the March of Dimes. It was Rotary International that led the Year of the Child to